The morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
I don't think about it very often, but other folks have said, Hugh, when you're healing calves for a branding, don't you ever worry about catching a finger in your dally and then not being able to play guitar? Well, the much-loved cowboy and singer Duke Davis thought about that for a while after a team roping wreck.
It didn't take long when he shot me out the door, and he did. I didn't break my arm, but it was a hairline fracture, you know. And it made a guitar pick real tough for about 3 months.
Now we'll have some stories from Duke today, along with a look back at 2022 on the Rangeland News.
I think the livestock side for 2022 has been a really interesting story because we see some pretty big increases.
And the well-known writer and reporter Wendy Dudley will come out of the vault to talk about what motivated her to write the best-selling book, Don't Name the Ducks.
Yeah, I kind of lay in the hospital going, my gosh, you know, I've got animals that aren't going to be exercised, hay that needs to be cut, fences that need to be mended, all those things that would tumble through anybody's mind in summer out on a ranch.
And I will tell you how I rode into trouble taking a young gelding out of the round pen for the first time on the Irvin Saddles and Western Wear horse training file. And we'll wrap it all up with a nice piece of cowboy poetry.
No telling where they'll take me when I hear a horse's feet, my imagination in the saddle just a-riding with the beat.
And the much-traveled rancher Stan Church has some interesting observations about the cowboys and gauchos and stockmen of South America after the late Kyle Evans and a tribute to his best horse.
He was never known to quit and never short of try. His old heart was big as this Dakota plain. He answered every calling with a will of do or die. And he always got me there and back again. For 20-some-odd years we rode the range together. He never faltered once along the way. From first light till setting sun through all kinds of weather, he was tough as any born back in his day. He was tough as any born back in his day. Now his mane is on his shoulder and his tail is on the ground. His muzzle's gray and he's cloudy in his eye. His frame is sagging badly, on legs no longer sound. And it's time to tell his working days goodbye. It's hard to say goodbye to the partner that he's been. He's the kind of friend no cowboy likes to lose. As I pull his halter one last time, I hope he understands. He's earned his final keep and paid his dues. And today I'll turn him out on the flats down by the river, on the bottom where the clear spring waters flow, to while away his days in the meadows there forever, in the valley where the sweetest grasses grow. In the valley where the sweetest grasses grow. His mane is on his shoulder and his tail is on the ground. His muzzle's gray and he's cloudy in his eye. His frame is sagging badly, on legs no longer sound. And it's time to tell his working days goodbye. And today I'll turn him out on the flats down by the river, on the bottom where the clear spring waters flow, to while away his days in the meadows there forever, in the valley where the sweetest grasses grow. In the valley where the sweetest grasses grow.
You know, the history of the cattle industry in South America is somewhat different from the way it's developed in North America, but a while back, one of our Spirit of the West cruises was near the coast of Colombia, and the well-known cattleman Stan Church was telling me what he's learned in his many travels in South America.
I really didn't realize that there was such a difference in the traditions, the trappings, the equipment, and the way cattle are handled in the gaucho traditions and by the cattlemen of Brazil.
Well, yes, I've been fortunate to travel down there a little bit. Argentina and Uruguay are still follow the Spanish tradition of the gaucho. They have a larger horse. They don't use quarter horses. And they're pretty rough around their livestock. Like to use the whips. There's lots of whips used. Whereas Brazil, and of course Brazil has the Portuguese background, but the Brazilians have looked to the United States and especially Texas, and they're more Texas than Texas. They're using quarter horses. They have used the Western saddle. They rope. They have rodeos that are the same as North American rodeos. As I was mentioning, in the towns you see half-ton trucks with rifles in the back window, and the guys are wearing Wranglers and cowboy hats, and you'd think they were right out of Texas. And cutting horse competitions are also big in Brazil. So Brazil is very Americanized. Argentina and Uruguay, they've stuck to their own tradition, and so they're very different.
Mm. And was it Argentina you were saying has the highest per capita consumption of beef in the Western world?
I think in the world, yes. I'm going by memory, but it's something like 160 pounds per person per year. And of course, beef is very cheap in Argentina. Many say that it's a proof that the protein diet works, because you don't see very many overweight Argentinians. Yet beef is their staple diet.
Coming up, a good cowboy and a fine singer and songwriter, Duke Davis, talks about some of his firsthand cowboy experience when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Whenever working cowboys get together, the debate continues, and so it will indefinitely, I think. Do you buckle your spur straps on the inside or the outside of your boots? Years ago, I had old hands tell me I had it wrong, no matter which way I did it. And of course, the other question regarding roping. Rubber on the horn, a short rope, and take your dallies. Long rope, slick horn, and slide your dallies. Or tie hard and fast. Well, a singer you can hear on this program fairly often, Duke Davis, has some thoughts on that. And after we discuss roping, you'll hear him sing.
Yeah, there you can probably hear Rex from both sides, but personally, I think taking a dally is my favorite, because I think you can get out of that.
Yeah, well, I turned a few loose. You ever had to turn your rope?
Yeah, just recently.
I see a few scars. What's behind that?
Well, we were actually team roping one day, and we were down in Yunus, New Mexico, and we just finished fall gather down there, and we were roping, and I actually had made a catch, and I went to dally up, and I had dropped my rein out of my hand, and so I dallied and went to turn, and there was no rein in my hand, and of course, we just made a beeline for the fence, you know, so I just had to let go of the rope and just come back and crop me across the hand there, you know. Yeah, a little high too.
I've never lost a finger so far, but I've had to drop my rope the odd time, and luckily somebody else with me was carrying one.
Yeah, it's funny too. I, of course, you know, playing music as long as I have too.
That's right.
The guys that I played in my bands and whatnot, I said, you know, don't you ever worry about losing your fingers, you know. I said, no, but don't get me near a pair of skis though.
Is that right?
I grew up in Texas, you know, in California you don't see skis, you know, and first time I started growing up in your country a little bit, in Wyoming, and getting around the snow, everybody in my band would ski. Of course, I had no idea what skis were, and I don't want to get near them because I'd probably kill myself. You know.
Well, I sure hope not, Duke, because your music is just the kind of stuff that's born in cowboy country. Now, this song might not make it to the top of the Billboard country charts because it's pure, clean, and acoustic. But when you go to a cowboy gathering or a festival, that's where you'll hear this kind of sound. Clear acoustic guitars, beautiful twin fiddles, and it's a sound that can sure soothe a cowboy's soul.
Echoes moon, brightly shining, there's magic in your mystic light. Sangre de Cristo, mountain adobe, holds the warmth from your glow tonight. I drifted up from hot and dusty Texas to the eastern slope of New Mexico. Just a cowboy searching for some sort of refuge from deep sand and the wind that always blows. I found a place where God had kissed the mountain, blessing the coyote with his lonely tune. He laced the land with a long and winding river and lit the sky with a yellow Pecos moon. Oh, Pecos moon, brightly shining, there's magic in your mystic light. Sangre de Cristo, mountain adobe, holds the warmth from your glow tonight. The Ponderosa reach up toward the heaven, and cattle graze on rolling grama grass. I feel the soul of Indians and cowboys that live in this valley in the past. The history of old traders haunt the shadows where canyons are alive with wild game. I hear a distant shot of Union soldiers that made a rebel's grave with no name. Oh, Pecos moon, brightly shining, there's magic in your mystic light. Sangre de Cristo, mountain adobe, holds the warmth from your glow tonight. The secrets that you hold of Western tales are buried here along the Santa Fe Trail. So now I'm home with kindred spirits. Shine on me, Pecos moon. So now I'm home kindred spirits, please shine on me, oh echoes moon.
That's Duke Davis from his highly acclaimed Chase the Wind CD. And Duke has cowboyed, in a lot of different parts of the West, and he has survived a wreck or two.
It kind of brings to mind one funny thing. It wasn't funny at the time, although I did get a pretty good poem out of it. But we were working cattle. I was working a ranch in Los Alamos, California, and we were doing a gather out there, and I had my horse and saddle, and I had a company horse and a company saddle as the second horse that day. And we were making a pretty good circle, you know. So in the afternoon, I switched my horse out and started riding that company horse. And I'm roping this yearling out from a little draw down there, and the tree broke on the saddle. And the fellow I was working for, he decided he'd just pound in a couple 3-inch nails and stick it back together. And I told him right then and there, I said, that ain't going to work, you know. And it'd be my luck, I'd have to draw that saddle sooner or later. Well, lo and behold, that was during the spring work. The following fall, a year and a half later, we were neighboring up with some other people up in Visalia. And I had this horse that was a company horse, and my saddle wouldn't fit it, so I went and got one out of the wagon, and it turned out to be that same saddle. So I hopped on this mare who was just kind of a scatterbrain anyway, and she come undone. That saddle was, she was kind of tiny anyway, and that saddle didn't fit her real well anyway. Of course, it didn't take long for a wreck to be in the making, you know. And she blew on me, and that saddle broke again. Well, of course, I was trying my best to stay with it, you know, and I went down one side of her, and by the time I was holding on underneath her, I figured better let loose of this wreck, you know. So I did, and I got pounded pretty good, but that horse kept kicking that saddle. It wouldn't come off, of course. And that horse ran around for a good 10 minutes, and there's like 10 cowboys trying to catch it, you know, and rope it, and everybody's missing, and she's jumping over the wagon and everything. Finally, I was only on a foot, and they finally got her squeezed in. They said, run in here and cut that cinch off. Well, I did, and I got hammered again, you know. So the moral of the story was, if you're ever going to, you know, borrow a company saddle, make sure it's never been busted, you know.
Well, it'd take more than a couple of 3-inch nails to fix it after she got through.
Yeah, that's right. It was kind of a funny story after it was over, but it didn't, at the time, it wasn't funny at all.
Next, I'll open up the vault, and you'll hear how a pretty bad accident with a horse was Wendy Dudley's motivation for writing a best-selling book, When the Spirit of the West, continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West.
Stories from the vault, from the Spirit of the West. This is where we dig deep for some of the most amazing stories from the folks who bring some heartwarming, knee-slapping, spellbinding episodes.
A few years back, well-known author Wendy Dudley told me about the motivation for writing her best-selling book, Don't Name the Ducks.
I think like a lot of writers, the book was in my mind for years. I had written a few of the chapters and thought, one day I'll get to the end of this book, but I don't know when, in between all the chores. And one of the characters in the book, Lucy, the red-headed mule, became a very central focus to this, in that one day I was riding her bareback with no bit. I just had the old rope halter on her, and I was rounding up the donkeys. And we decided to take a little trot downhill, and I very unceremoniously lost my balance, hung on to her neck, thinking, oh darn, I'm going to have to find a fence or a low spot or a high spot to get back on her.
You'd ridden her bareback with a halter before, though, with no problems, right?
Oh, all the time. This was our afternoon ritual, was just to go out and okay, I'd take her over to the fence line and hop on her back. So it wasn't like, you know, anything disastrous happened. She didn't spook, she didn't buck. She just decided very merrily while we were going to trot down this hill. And being a mule and out of a mare that didn't have high withers, well, I just started to slide down towards her neck and lost my balance. And darn it, I think we have one rock in that field, and my hip found the rock when I tumbled to the ground, and I broke my hip. So having been told that I could not put any weight on the leg for 4.5 months, I was desperate for something to do. I couldn't drive, work.
What happened? You hit the ground? Did it knock you out, or what? How did you get back? What happened?
Well, that's a story in itself, Hugh. Actually, no, I didn't know anything was broken because it wasn't, a full-blown wreck. I just essentially fell off like a sack of potatoes. I just thought I pulled a lot of ligaments and muscles. And so I crawled on my belly down to a willow bush and cracked off a branch there, thinking, well, I'll just use this to hobble home. And the donkeys were racing around the field braying because they knew that something wasn't quite right. And the stick wasn't cutting it. I mean, I was now going into quite a spasm in this leg, and I thought, gee, I really have pulled a lot of muscles here. And it wasn't until the paramedics got there, and I was still sort of joking around about all these muscles I'd pulled, when the paramedic somewhat announced that, don't you dare move, from what you've told me, I think you've broken your hip. And he said, you have a femoral artery right there, and if you move, you can sever that. And I guess that sort of let me down hard, almost as hard as I'd hit the rock. And that, yeah, you're right. Was I thinking then, oh, this is a great opportunity to write a book? No, all I could think of is, oh my gosh, knowing we were in for a long haul, if indeed this was a broken hip. And of course, the x-rays revealed that indeed I had done that, so they had to put 3 pins in it. But this was summer. This was June 6th. And my mom doesn't drive. So here's us two old gals out there. We cut our hay with a scythe and do most things by hand because we're so mechanically inept, we can't keep anything running. So, yeah, I kind of lay in the hospital going, my gosh, you know, I've got animals that aren't going to be exercised, hay that needs to be cut, fences that need to be mended, all those things that would tumble through anybody's mind in summer out on a ranch. And so it was probably a week later when I realized, well, I can either sit here and feel terribly sorry for myself or try to turn it into a positive and write this book. And maybe something too, you know, great will come out of that. But it's a summer we do not want to repeat. If my mother were here, there were a few times when she turned to me. She said, if you ever do this again, I am leaving. And I thought, well, at least wait until I'm back walking again. But we survived. And like a lot of situations like that, I mean, it's either going to do you in or bring you closer. And again, we look back at it now and laugh. But believe me, it was no laughing matter at the time.
From a radiator cap to an engine block, BZTractorParts.com is your source for whatever you need to keep that essential implement in top shape. Specializing in quality new replacement parts for agricultural tractors, Massey Ferguson, Ford, John Deere, David Brown, Case, International Harvester, Universal Deutz Leyland, Landini, Oliver Fiat, Alice, Zetor, White, and a lot more. If you don't have internet, just call Mark at 250-395-0960. One click or one call, and the parts will be on their way. BZTractorParts.com. Now, just ahead of the Rangeland news, here's another good one from the prairie songbird Eli Barzy, and I think Doris Daly helped Eli with this one.
I'm looking through the window of the west, looking back to the days I loved the best. Let me go, let me dream, I'll be blessed. Looking out through the window of the west, I could see her eyes fill with tears as she heard that old time song. She grabbed her Takamine guitar and began to strum along. That old tune just took her back to when she was a child. She'd catch her pinto pony and rode the prairies wild. And every now and then she gets a glimpse of yesterday. It seems more now than ever I get to hear her say, I'm looking through the window of the west, looking back to the days I loved the best. Let me go, let me dream, I'll be blessed. Looking out through the window of the west. He was only 5 years old when they packed and hit the trail. His mom and dad and little bro struggled hard to no prevail. covered wagon, dusty clothes. You'd think the times were tough, but his memories of those good old days, he can never get enough. And every now and then he gets a glimpse of yesterday. He glances out the back door, I softly hear him say, I'm looking through the window of the west, looking back to the days I loved the best. Let me go, let me dream, I'll be blessed, looking out through the window of the west. Open the windows wide, let the distant wind blow through. Close your eyes and wander through a time that you once knew. I'm looking through the window of the west, looking back to the days I loved the best. Let me go, let me dream, I'll be blessed, looking out through the window of the west. I'm looking out through the window of the west.
The Rangeland News from the Spirit of the West. A roundup of issues and events from the world of agriculture.
At the top of page one, it says, in spite of record high input prices for almost everything, including fuel, fertilizer, feed, parts, and much more, net income for farms and ranches did okay in 2022. And with the rest of the story, here's Gary Crawford.
The new USDA farm income forecast for 2022 projects cash receipts from the sale of crops to be up 19% from last year. That's a big jump. But
I think the livestock side for 2022 has been a really interesting story because we see some pretty big increases.
USDA's chief economist Seth Meyer says total cash receipts from livestock and livestock products will grow even more than the crop side. We got details on that from Spiro Stefano. He runs the USDA's Economic Research Service, and he told us by the end of this year,
we're going to see dairy increasing dramatically, you know, nearly 30%. Cow-calf operations, 12.1%. Broilers are up 46%. Eggs are up over 100%.
Cash receipts for hogs will be about even with last year's excellent sales. So, in total, cash receipts for all livestock and livestock products this year could top last year by almost 31%. Gary Crawford for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
The supply chain that brings meat to market worldwide is a pretty complex and usually very efficient system, but when disruptions in one part of the world happen, they can result in transportation delays, an ocean and a continent away. Meat spoilage becomes a real risk to food producers, vendors, and consumers, and this is especially true if food inspection protocols are kind of lax. So, to improve food safety, a group of Concordia researchers designed a new, inexpensive, reliable, and consumer-friendly technology that identifies the presence of the toxin putrescine in beef. And as its name sounds like, putrescine is responsible for the noxious odor of putrefying meats, and if consumed in large doses, it can cause headaches, vomiting, diarrhea, and heart palpitations, and it's also been linked to higher risks of colorectal cancer. And while a fully functional, commercially available version of the biosensor won't be available anytime soon, the researchers are optimistic about its potential. The cattle industry is in mourning over the loss of rancher and leader Red Schellenberg after his sudden passing back on December the 2nd, 2022. Reg operated a ranch along with his wife Shannon at Beachy, Saskatchewan, and he was the president of the Canadian Cattle Association, having assumed that role in March of this year. and Reg was first elected as a director for the CCA in 2010. He served as co-chair of the Foreign Trade Committee from 2020 to 22, and he co-chaired the Animal Health and Care Committee with Pat Hayes from 2016 to 2020. He also represented the CCA on the Canadian Cattle Identification Agency, and prior to the creation of the Animal Health and Care Committee, he chaired the Animal Care Committee. And Nathan Finney of New Brunswick now steps into the role of president. An Alberta company loaded up the big prize at the Agri-Trade Equipment Expo's Ag Innovations Competition in December. Opend Range Limited of Daysland was awarded the $20,000 grand prize for its Cowgo loading system that turns any cattle liner into a ground load trailer. Made of aluminum, the ramp and the side panels can be set up by one person in under a minute. The ramp pulls out of a subfloor and the side panels fold out and attach to the ramp. Instant loading chute. And Drifting with the Herd is the title of a brand new book by the well-known cowboy and clinician Miles Kingdon. It's his second book, and if it's anything like his first, it'll be a real page-turner. And Vernon's Rob Dinwiddie did the illustrations, and you can go to mileskingdonhorsemanship.com to order it. And the next regular cattle sale at the BC Livestock Kamloops Yards will be on January 24th. There's a bred cow and heifer sale then on January 31st, and the next sale scheduled for Williams Lake will be February 23rd. Get all the information and see the sales live at bclivestock.bc.ca. And meanwhile, at the Innisfail Auction Market, regular cattle sales every Wednesday now, and the pre-sort sale, the first one of the new year, will be Monday, January 23rd. To consign your cattle, just give Danny, Mark, or Dwayne a call, 1-800-710-3166, or see InnisfailAuctionMarket.com. And now the final item, a cattle buyer that a lot of you may know. It turned out was checking into hospital to undergo a minor surgical procedure. And if you've ever checked into hospital, you know how the procedure goes. And the admissions clerk was filling out all the admissions forms and was asking all kinds of questions about his health, medical history, and his personal information. And finally, the clerk said, "Okay, sir, this is the last question. In the event of an emergency, who should we call?" Well, after several seconds of deep thought, our cattle buyer friend finally answered, 911. And that's the Rangeland News. Next on the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, I'll take you through a rough spot I got myself into, taking a 3-year-old gelding out in the round pen for the first time, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. The Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File is coming right up, and I'll take you through what happened when I was a little early taking a young 3-year-old gelding out of the round pen and out to the big pasture for the first time. First, though, January 16th. Wow, that's not very far away. But that's when the Spirit of the West Cruise Gang will be flying to Los Angeles for a night in a luxury hotel. And then on January 17th, they're all going to board the beautiful Emerald Princess for an unforgettable 16-day cruise through the new Panama Canal locks and all the way up to Fort Lauderdale. And along the way, they'll be seeing 6 countries, including Mexico, Los Angeles, the USA, Puerto Vallarta, Mexico, Hotelco, Mexico, San Juan, Nicaragua, Putaneras, Costa Rica, where they'll have a special farm tour, and Panama City, Panama, as well as Cartagena, Colombia, and then finally Fort Lauderdale. That special farm tour in Costa Rica, that'll really be something. And I just found out that Ed and Diane Peak from Drumheller will be among the many past cruisers joining all our first-timers. And, you know, it would be worth going there just to hear Ed sing and play guitar. Oh, yeah, there will, of course, be lots of sing-alongs, and you'll be able to follow along on our cruise page at hugh-mclennan.com and on the Spirit of the West Cruise Facebook page. And Mark and Kathy McMillan, our longtime support crew, will be your hosts, and they do everything right. And you know what? We had a sneak peek at what's planned for the 2024 Spirit of the West Cruise, and I can tell you it'll be spectacular. We'll keep you posted, and for more information, you can just call toll-free 1-800-530-0131. Thank you, Lucky. This is the Irvin Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File.
Here in Alberta, winter's no picnic, but it's a lot less scary when you suit up head to toe with help from my friends at Irvin Tack and Western Wear. Something for everyone, cowboys and cowgirls to city folks too. Western Wear with a welcome twist. Jean shirts, hoodies, jackets, gloves, and brand new boots from Irvin's Boot Ranch. From casual to job site certified, Irvin's is over 110,000 feet of selection to keep your family feeling warm and wonderful. Exit 305 off Highway 2 by Crossfield. Canada's largest Western store.
It's too bad there wasn't an audience. It would have made a pretty good clinic. In the second week of working with a 3-year-old gelding, and resistance was beginning to show up. Out in the big pasture, just the colt and I with about a foot of snow on the ground, and riding him in the round pen was great. He'd walk, trot, lope, yield softly to rein and leg pressure, and just give me a beautiful stop. But out in the big pasture, things were different. As we headed away from home to make a big circle, 600 feet across or so, things really bothered him as we got further from the home gate and managed to complete the circle, but I wanted to really short-circuit the resistance I could feel building in this good colt. Whenever we got to the sweet spot in the pattern, he would stop. He wanted, naturally, to head back to the other horses in the home pasture, but because he'd learned lateral flexion, it was easy to keep him pointed the way I wanted. Now, the old instincts say, jab him with my spurs, smack him with the reins, do anything to get him going. A little deeper understanding, though, leads to a different approach. And here's how I handled it. One of my goals was to get him to back up softly and willingly. Well, every time he stopped, I kept him straight, took up all the slack in the reins, and waited till he came off the bit, taking a minimum of 2 steps backwards. And then, after letting him stand for about 30 seconds, I would give a gentle squeeze with my legs, and he moved ahead. I released the squeeze, and he walked ahead nicely. Took about 3 trips around the circuit to completely melt this resistance away, but the key to this whole business is enough patience to wait and sense just what the horse is feeling.
And for Irvin Saddles and Western Wear, that's the horse training file. Boy, something that sure keeps our horses looking good and feeling good is a daily feeding of Hoffman's Horse Ration. It'll probably work for your horses too. Just check out hoffmanshorseproducts.com. You know, the first time we took part in the Ivan Danes Country Music Picnic many years ago, with everything going on at the picnic, Ivan hooked up his trailer, saddled his horse, and loaded him up and said, "Hugh and Billy, jump in the pickup. We're going to Olds. I'm entered in the team penny." It was quite a ride down there, but I think their team won. And here's Ivan.
It's growing like the grass after spring rains. In the south, in the north, the east and west the same. Sport where 3 riders ride into a herd. Cut 3 cattle out and pen them, but that's not insured. It's called team penny, a sport that's sweeping across the lands. A horse, a saddle, some reins in your hand. It's something like a feeling in a song. You, your horse, your partners, when you can do no wrong. Of course, that luck can change without rhyme, reason, or call. You come up empty, you lose them all. Some may think team penny's a new event. In 1949, Canadian cowboy Bill Schwinn, Joe and Ray Yanez, top California hands, were penning steers out of a herd, came up with a plan. Venture is fair and rodeo is coming soon. Let's ask Andy Urigi if he'll give us some room. Now Andy's in Pro Rodeo's Hall of Fame. He had the foresight in the rodeo game. Started with 2 penners, then went to 3 in time. In the horse world, it's big at pennings, you'll see the lines. You've got to put faith in your horse and plan. There's Doc Bars, Driftwood's, Gunsmoke's, Colonel Freckles and Pappy Sands, Frenchman's, Poco's, Dash for Cash, 2-Eyed Jacks, Easy Jet, Go Man Go, those coon tails sure scat. There's lots of others that are in arenas now. they've got to love it. Work and pen a cow, you're numbered 1, 2, 5, youth, woman, man. When you're rated 5, you're a top pen and hand. In the mountains, on the plains, deserts below, there's always a pennant, won't win if you don't go. There's something about pennant that you can't explain. You'll get that feeling when they call your name. Do 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 do.
Now, getting bucked off out on the range is bad enough, but if you're in the arena, it can be even more embarrassing. But that did happen to Duke Davis one time.
I've had my own horse buck me off in arena one time. I had this real nice running quarter and just got him started roping. And he was just 4. He's just short of 4, and he's doing pretty good, but he's real hot around cattle. You know, you'd have to really limber him up. And he sat for about a month while I was out on the road, and I came back and with no intentions of doing anything except, you know, putting him in the round pen and getting a little work in. And Mike, who owned the ranch, come up to the round pen. He said, "Hey, we got some new steers in today. Let's go rope." And well, by golly, my horse was—he's making his lead changes nice, and he wasn't hot. And we went down to the arena and penned the cattle and everything. And he was really calm and relaxed and everything. And I thought, well, by golly, let's just rope. So we went in and I was heading, and I come out of that header box and was standing up rating that old steer, and he just come unglued on me, you know, and went to bucking at a full run. And I went to thump him, and I realized I didn't have any spurs on, which I always had a spur on my boot. They just stay on my boot, but having no intentions of doing anything but being a round pin that day, I just didn't have a spur on, didn't think twice about it. So when I realized I didn't have any iron on my legs, I just threw my rope down and gave my best Monty Henson thing for about 3 or 4 jumps, you know, and it didn't take long for he shot me out the door, and he did. I didn't break my arm, but it was a hairline fracture, you know, and it made it guitar picking real tough for about 3 months. Yeah.
Boy, there's some interesting ones. I came off flat on my back on the frozen ground twice, 2 years apart. Now I can't even bend over and pull off a set of shoes anymore. That was the worst of it.
Yeah.
Other than that, I've been pretty lucky.
Well, you know, that country you guys are in, I really admire you and envy you. That's some real pretty country. The few times I've been up there, and I've never been up there when it's been dead of winter, but a little bit in Alberta, but I sure like that country y'all are in. It looks like it's good cow country, too.
Well, that's kind of a nice note to sort of wrap this up on, Duke, and I hope that maybe we'll see you up in Western Canada at some point in the future, and I'd like to thank you very much for sitting down with us here on the Spirit of the West today.
Well, thank you. It's been a pleasure, and I'm sure we will get up to your country soon, and God bless you all.
This week's piece of cowboy poetry is something I sure hope you can hear. It's coming up when the Spirit of the West continues right after this.
Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. One of the Old West outlaws I heard about when I was just a kid was, of course, the notorious Billy the Kid. He was born, well, there's not a whole lot known for sure about him, but researchers figure he was born November 23rd, 1859 in New York City and died July 14th, 1881 in Fort Sumner, New Mexico, shot by Sheriff Pat Garrett. And Billy was actually one of the most notorious gunfighters in his early life, although he claimed to have killed about 21 men. The actual number is less than 10. And at age 21, he was gunned down. Some things you might not know about him. He was orphaned as a teen. Not much is known about his early days. His first arrest came for stealing clothes from a laundry. And he did play a prominent part in an early frontier feud, but he never did rob a train or a bank, unlike some of the other Old West outlaws like Billy Miner. As a kid, or a child, Billy the Kid went under the name of Henry McCarty, but scholarly opinions divided under that or William H. Bonney Jr. The name that was actually used in this trial was his true name. And here's another hypothesis that might be a little far out there. It says that he was, in fact, Ole L. Brushy Bill Roberts, who escaped, lived in Mexico and the U.S. Southwest, and rode in Wild West shows, and died in 1950 in Ego, Texas. Whatever that may be, here's Marty Robbins.
I'll sing you a true song of Billy the Kid. I'll sing of some desperate deeds that he did. Way out in New Mexico, long, long ago, when a man's only chance was his old 44. When Billy the Kid was a very young lad, in old Silver City he went to the bad. Way out in the West with a gun in his hand, at the age of 12 years he did kill his first man. There's Mexican maidens play guitars and sing songs about Billy, their boy bandit king. Ere his young manhood has reached its sad end, with a notch on his pistol for 21 men. Was on a sad night when poor Billy died. He said to his friends, I'm not satisfied. There's 21 men I have put bullets through. Sheriff Pat Garrett must make 22. I'll sing you how Billy the Kid met his fate. The bright moon was shining, the hour was late. Shot down by Pat Garrett, who once was his friend. The young outlaw's life has now come to an end. There's many a man with a face fine and fair, who start out in life with a chance to be square. Just like poor Billy, they wander astray. They'll lose their lives in the very same way.
And now the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight shines brightly on Tom Swearingen.
I hear something special when a horse hoof hits the ground. There's nothing else as magic as the rhythm of that sound. Could be a gentle clip-clop ambling down the street, or thunder at the gallop, all a blur of legs and feet. Don't matter whether barefoot or shod with nails and steel, there's nothing else I've heard gives me quite the feel. I've heard the greatest orchestras and a diva's glorious song, and choirs harmonizing like a grand angelic throng. I have seen the late and great ones, from Elvis to George Jones, those with voices that move and shake you deep into your bones. But I hear something special when a horse hoof hits the ground. There's nothing else as magic as the rhythm of that sound. I've heard a child's first words and the whinny of a newborn foal, the beautiful songs of yesteryear and classic poems of old, the echoes through the canyon when a coyote calls a friend, the gentle sound of evening breeze at daylight's peaceful end. And yes, those sounds are wonderful, and each speaks to my soul, but so does the sound of hoofbeats when horses are on a roll. When I hear a horse's hoofbeats, no telling what I'll find, with imagination running free, painting pictures in my mind. Future Derby winner leading on the rail. Pony Express rider rushing someone's mail. Finals barrel racer turning on a dime. Old country doctor's buggy arriving just in time. Desperado's getaway following a spree. Posse hot behind, aiming to hang him in a tree. A bred to buck saddle bronc flanked and just set loose. Proud Umatilla on a swift cayuse. A bulldogger and hazer closing on a steer. Revolution warning ride of patriot Paul Revere. Or the horses I grew up with when I was just a pup. Flicka, Silver, Trigger, and my stick horse, Giddy-Up. No telling where they'll take me when I hear a horse's feet, my imagination in the saddle just a-riding with the beat. Because I hear something special when a horse hoof hits the ground. There's nothing else as magic as the rhythm of that sound.
Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for joining up and riding along, and I sure hope you can be right back here next week at the same time. And as always, thanks to our great support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan, now scrambling to make sure all of our shows get to your radio even while they're on our Panama Canal cruise. We've got some news coming up about the next Spirit of the West cruise for 2024. It's going to be spectacular. Stay tuned. Now be sure to check out Canadian Cowboy Country Magazine for great reading. You can subscribe online at canadiancowboy.ca. And I hope you can check out our YouTube channel where you can see and hear this show and a lot of our past projects, and you can download us as a podcast. Take us with you. The links are at our website, hugh-mclennan.com. Till next week, I'm Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.